everybody, wherever you may be, from coast to coast and sea to shining sea. Welcome back to the Shack. Yes. Thank you for coming this Wednesday. Wherever you may be, welcome to Ham Radio Live.
Little south side of Chicago is the baddest part of town. And if you go down there, you better just beware of a man named Leroy Brown. Now, Leroy, morning trouble. You see, you stand about 6'4". All the downtown ladies call him Treetop Lover. All the men just call him.
All right,
him
sing along, everybody.
And it's bad.
Wherever you're coming from, the four winds of the world, away we go. Hello, everybody. Welcome back to Shack in Oregon. My name's Larry. My call sign's Kilo 7 Hotel November. What an honor it is to see you on this Wednesday. Thank you for coming. December the 1st. We've hit the last month of the year. Welcome to the show. It's good to see you. We're going to talk today about the other part of a receive antenna. Yesterday we talked about, remember, we talked about beverages. Today we're going to talk about loops. Now we're going to talk about loops in a different way than we talked about yesterday. And I hope you like it. We're going to talk about ground loops. Yeah, you can actually put a loop on the ground, and it works very, very well. We're going to talk about that today. Plus, we've also got a couple of pretty cool, entertaining trivia questions, and hopefully some good news information for you as well. Welcome to the show. First of all, we're going to welcome some folks in. My brother Bob, first time again. Really?
Bob,
you're making it a habit. Hey, Bob. Welcome. It's good to see you. Hi, Ron, up in Canada. His call sign is Victor Alpha 3, Foxtrot Union Charlie. Also has a very nice YouTube channel. Check him out here on YouTube at Canadian Maker Project or Victor Alpha 3, Foxtrot Union Charlie. Cliff Bolts is here from the state of Virginia. Hi, Cliff. A very happy Wednesday to you, my friend. Whiskey Delta 4, Oscar Bravo, Papa. Mark Taylor is back from the UK. Mike 7, Echo Sierra Sierra. Thanks for coming. David Luricia, all the way from Argentina, is back, and that's wonderful. Welcome. David, it's always a pleasure. Thank you for coming. Lima Whiskey 4, Delta Alpha Foxtrot. Thank you. Gary Strong is here from the beautiful, beautiful city of Las Vegas, Nevada. Whiskey 9, Papa Papa Yankee. Hello to you, as well as Mike in Jacksonville. Kilo Delta 2, Sierra X-ray Delta. I want to tell you, everything's ready to go at WRMI. Tomorrow, the first show airs to Hawaii and South Pacific, plus Australia and New Zealand on WRMI. Listen on 7730 kilohertz at 0815 UTC, please. It'll be right there, and you'll be able to hear this show in a condensed version, only about 14 and a half minutes. But we'll have HF news, a little bit of forecast stuff, plus we'll have a good mailbag segment. I hope you enjoy it. To Europe and North Africa, plus the Middle East, it'll be tomorrow as well at 2015 UTC. That's going to be on 15770 kilohertz. Please join us for CQ calling at WRMI. To North America, it's coming on Thursday, 7:30 p.m. Eastern Time, 4:30 p.m. in the Pacific Time Zone on 9395 kilohertz. Please join me for that show. To the Caribbean, South America, and Central America, Thursday, 8:15 Eastern on 9955 kilohertz. By the way, the Thursday 8:15 p.m. Eastern broadcast also can be simulcast on their internet stream at www.wrmi.net. Plus, it'll also be found on Streama as well. So that'll be pretty cool. Whole purpose of why we are here is to help you get an amateur radio. Maybe you don't know how to get your license. Well, here is how. Contact any of these five radio groups. Hit the contact us bar. Let them know where you're located. Then what they'll do is they'll send you an email back that's going to have information about a radio club that's close to you. Contact that club. Get to know them, all right? They're going to help you get your license. They might even have some gear they can lend you once you get your license, and they'll help you out with your questions about amateur radio. The first one, American Radio Relay League. Hit them up at www.arl.org. Remember, hit the contact us bar. If you're in UK or you'd like to contact the Radio Society of Great Britain, it's a wonderful group. Contact them at www.rsgb.org. Up in Canada, the Radio Amateurs of Canada is a wonderful club, and you can find them at www.rac.ca. In Japan, the Japan Amateur Radio League at www.jarl.org. And in Australia and Tasmania, the Wireless Institute of Australia at www.wia.org. If you'd like to email the show, And if you have a question, by the way, for the WRMI broadcast, maybe you'd like it to be heard over the air with an answer over the air as well that you can hear on shortwave, please hit me up at cqhamradiolive@gmail.com. That's cqhamradiolive@gmail.com. Today's topic question, what goal would you like to accomplish in radio? Now, this is a wide topic, right? Because it could be CB, it could be ham, it could be shortwave, it could be medium wave DXing. What's one of your goals? We'll talk about that today. Want to welcome Matt Missenmacher this Saturday, December 4th at 20 UTC. That's going to be at 8 p.m. London, okay? If you're in Western Europe, that's 9 p.m. Eastern Europe, 10 p.m. Here in the States, in the West, that's high noon. In the East, 3 p.m. We're going to talk about his brand new app for your phone, tablet, laptop. It's amazing. Super QSO is the name of it. You can download it free on your app or Google Play Store. It is brilliant. It's made for hams. You have to have a legal ham license. Once he verifies that, then you are good to go, and you can talk about, you know, your gear, maybe where you're going to be, you know, going to. Maybe you want a good ham-friendly location, for example. Maybe you're buying or selling gear. Maybe you're working at POTA, and you want to, you know, say what frequencies you're on. What a great idea. Meet Matt this coming Saturday at December 4th. That's at 20 UTC. Then the following Saturday, that's going to be December 11th at 20 UTC. Alex Villadares, W7HU Radio from here on YouTube, going to be joining us. So excited for that show. We're going to talk to Alex about his channel, about his station, about his life. It's going to be a wonderful show. And I am so grateful to have Alex join me here. Again, that's on the following Saturday. That's December 11th at 20 UTC. That's 8 p.m. if you're in London, all right? The following Saturday, December 18th, meet Jeff White, the general manager of WRMI. He's going to join us to answer questions about WRMI radio. If you wonder, you know, a lot of stations have call signs that mean something. Well, in this case, it does. It means Worldwide Radio Miami International. And they broadcast at 1.4 million watts. Yes, 1.4 million watts. That's exactly right.
1.21 gigawatts!
Yeah, pretty much. That's pretty much it. So they broadcast all over the world. And that's, I am so excited to be a part of their crew there, WRMI. I can't wait for the first show. It airs tomorrow, by the way. It's all in the system. It's all ready to go. Meet Jeff on the 18th. That's 20 UTC. If you're over in Europe, it's going to be 8 p.m., 9 p.m. Western Europe, 10 p.m. in the eastern part of Europe, 3 p.m. Eastern United States, and noon Pacific. Welcome. It's good to see you guys. Let's catch up. A lot of folks joined in. And man, all of a sudden, the stream just went bang. Hi, Ian. Ian is here from the Netherlands. Papa Alpha Zero Romeo November Hotel. Welcome back. It's great to see you, Ian. Happy evening to you there in Norway. It's great to see you. Sorry, in Holland. Thank you for coming. It's truly an honor. Andy Cowley, 2 Echo Zero, Romeo Echo Echo. Hello to you. It's nice to see you, mate. Wow, what a treat. Oh, my goodness. Tom is here all the way in Bahrain. Alpha 9, 2 Golf Whiskey. His U.S. call sign, Alpha Echo 1, Tango Papa. It's almost midnight where Tom is. Tom, thank you for coming. Wow, what a treat. It's good to see you. Adam is here, November Yankee 5 Echo, all the way from Ocala, Florida. Hello there. Said good afternoon, Larry, and all those Ham Radio Live listeners. Thank you, Adam. It's a pleasure to have you here. Thank you very, very much. Wow. Swordfish Radio is here. That's Golf 7 Foxtrot, Foxtrot Tango November. So Golf 7 Foxtrot Tango November, all the way from the UK. That's Martin. Welcome. And, you know, I think he's got some YouTube stuff too, right? You've got YouTube stuff too. So check it out. Really, check these people's content out. It takes a while to put this stuff together. And it's really, really good. I think you'll enjoy it. Tom. Look at this. Tom in Bahrain's already answering the question, the trivia question. It's great. Adam from Ocala, Florida. Did your dad ever get his Vandy call sign? Did he miss that memo? No. There was an error that was made in the sending, the application. It must be perfect, of course. So we've reapplied and should be, I think, this week or next at the latest, according to what the FCC says. So hopefully, we keep hoping and waiting. So we'll see. East Tennessee is here. Hi, Jeff. November 4, Papa Oscar Delta, 5-9 in Eastern Genesee. I love being in East Tennessee. Man, beautiful area. Love Tennessee. Beautiful state. If you've never been, it's a great place. Tom in Bahrain going to be scanning to search the broadcast tomorrow. I hope you enjoy it, Tom. I really do. I seriously do. You know, this is a fun thing for me. I enjoy it so much. First time I've been on the air since 2000, so I'm really excited to go and put another show together. And there's our brand new ham, Anders Kyle, Lima Bravo 3, Bravo Juliet. Welcome to Ham Radio. Welcome back. Anders, it's great to see you. Don is back from the UK. That's Yoki. Hi, Larry. I hope all is well. We'll reply to your email later. No problem. Kevin is here. Mike Zero, Mike Charlie Lima. Greetings from the UK. Thank you for coming. As well as we've got Portugal back. That's Charlie Tango 1, Juliet Romeo Zulu. And that's an honor. Thank you for coming from Portugal. Victor, thank you. Thank you sincerely for coming. My goodness. Wow. Plus Lee Roselli is here. Hi, Lee. Whiskey 8, Romeo November Bravo. Hey, Larry. I'm enjoying POTA most every day. Do you play POTA? No. No, I really don't. I've got a schedule that's kind of hard to do a lot of remote stuff. I've got the stuff to do it, but I don't get a chance to do it much, but would like to. It's a nice hobby. Wow, Portugal. Victor, thanks for coming. Charlie Tango 1, Juliet Romeo Zulu. What an honor to see you. In Ham Radio News, Youth on the Air Month continues to expand into the Americas. You know, December is Youth on the Air Month. It celebrates, encourages youth on the air. Amateur radio operators who are 25 years old and younger will be on the air at special event stations around the world, and that means the world, throughout December in celebration of youth in amateur radio. Youth on the Air Month stations will be on all bands and modes at various times. Now, in the U.S., the call signs will once again be Kilo 8 Yankee, Kilo 8 Oscar, Kilo 8 Tango, and Kilo 8 Alpha. Three new DXCC entities will be participating for the first time. Argentina will be active as Lima Romeo 1, Youth on the Air, so Yankee Oscar Tango Alpha. Cuba as Charlie Oscar 0, Yankee Oscar Tango Alpha. And Peru, that's great, Oscar Alpha 0, Yankee Oscar Tango Alpha. Other countries may be added. Listen for these stations as well as call signs with the YOTA suffixes, okay? Work a Youth on the Air. Last year, 28 operators in the Americas participated in the Youth on the Air Month, and this year, Youth in the Americas anticipates an increased level of youth activity from South America. Last year, young hams around the world surpassed their goal of 100,000 contacts during Youth on the Air Month, with a final tally of 137,000 stations in the Americas logged, 14,700 of those contacts. That's pretty cool. ARISS USA announces new senior leadership. The U.S. segment of amateur radio on the International Space Station has augmented its senior leadership team with five new members. In May 2020, ARISS-USA created a new 503c3 nonprofit charitable organization to enhance and expand ARISS initiatives in the U.S. ARISS says the new membership will support the variety of new functions and roles within ARISS-USA. Martin, who goes by Marty Schulman, November Victor 3 Hotel, will be associate director working with executive director Frank Bauer, Kilo Alpha 3 Hotel Delta Oscar, in delegating routine tasks, enhancing perspective, and backing up the executive director as necessary. If you want more information on this, find this, by the way, on the ARL website. IARU reports another over-the-horizon radar system is under construction. Yeah, this isn't good stuff. No, not at all. In October, the International Amateur Radio Union Region 1 Monitoring Systems newsletter reported that continuing run of over-the-horizon radar troublemakers that often cause severe interference on amateur radio bands, primarily in IARU Regions 1 and 3, but are audible in the rest of the world. Now another threat is coming. IARU Region 1 says that this is actually, now it's kind of called the Alpha Defense India Unit, that the Defense Research and Development Organization, Premier Radio Development Laboratory, is working on. Another system is trying to keep an eye on the Chinese movements in the Indian Ocean region. The system design has already been completed, according to the report. The prototype stage comes next. Now, here's the issue. Over-the-horizon radars often massively interfere with amateur radio, the IARU Region 1 report said, citing the well-known Russian container OTHR and OTHR at the UK base in the Republic of Cyprus and others in Iran and China. They are present daily on several frequencies within the exclusive amateur radio HF bands, IARU Region 1 said. The best-known Chinese over-the-horizon radar, called Foghorn because of its distinctive sound, has signals at varying sweep rates that occupy 10 kilohertz of spectrum.
Wow.
Recorded other over-the-horizon radars are occupying up to 160 kilohertz of bandwidth with 10 scan per second rates. Depending upon propagation, some familiar broadcast stations were also audible almost daily in Europe, including Radio Ethiopia on 7110 with an often very strong signal, the newsletter also reported. So this is kind of one of those things that isn't the greatest. So we'll keep an eye on it for you. Today's question, by the way, what goal would you like to still accomplish in radio, whether it be ham, shortwave, maybe your CB, maybe your DXing, you know, AM, who knows? Let's take a look and see what your comments are already. We'll find out, and we'll find out and see how things go. First of all, let's get up with Ron. That question for me, it makes contact with the ISS and a reply back. That's great. Oh, my gosh. You know, I've wanted to do that, too. Yeah, same thing, Ron. That'd be great to be able to contact the space station. It goes over, and I can see it, right? But it's like I can't make a call to it. It's like they're either sleeping or they're not home. Well, I hope they're home. Yeah, you know what I'm saying. Anyway, all right, so other people have this question. Let's see what we've got on your thing, what you're saying. I'm just trying to catch up. Again, what would you like to accomplish you in radio? Mike from Jacksonville, POTA is field day every day. It's true. That's true. Jeff wants to start planning for winter field day. That's going to be fun coming up in January, so that should be good. Let's get to the weather. It's powered by ICOM. ICOM for the love of ham radio. I'd love to tell you, you'll love the forecast. However, I don't think so today. Here's the A1A. There are sunspots. We have 61 as a solar number today, but we don't have great conditions because we have a heavy solar wind and it's pointed southward. People that are experienced in radio know that that means it can mess up propagation, especially in the north. Here is the backside view, and here is coronal hole number 27 that's causing the trouble right now to us, okay?
No!
Yeah, pretty bad. So what's happening right now? Take a look at the CME. Now, this is the K-index. Take a look. It went up to a K5 earlier, then it stuck at K4, and it's been bounced up and down. It's still unsettled at K3, but it's not terrible. The geomagnetic storms in process, this is from solarham.net. An enhanced solar wind stream is containing a sector of southward BZ has kicked up a minor G1 geomagnetic storm. Aurora sky watchers at higher latitudes should be alert if it's dark outside. The K-index of 5 actually came up yesterday at 2238 UTC, and it was an active warning. It now has calmed down, so it's in better condition. Current conditions out of Boulder, SFI look 85, and we talked about that. I think the coming week will be in the 80s. Solar number is 61. A is 11, which is high. K is 3. BZ latitude now is even, which is good. Solar wind also down. It was over 500 kilometers per second. It's just under that now at 498.2 kilometers per second. Moon bouncers have excellent conditions. However, because of the solar wind and what's going on, we do have unsettled conditions, but I think it'll get better as the day goes on. Current MUFs, Alaska 8.82. If you're in Ascension Island, 41.24, great. Again, mid-latitudes are great. Knife Island, 19.10, and Darwin, Australia, wake it up to 20.66 megahertz. The Kilo Troy 2 golf map, presented by Mike the Map Guy here on the channel. If you're in the northern part of the United States, all the way down to Baja, by the way, see how it sweeps? It goes all the way from Baja up or through the big Great Plains into southern Canada, and then back down right around where North Carolina, you know, juts out, 23 megahertz. If you're on the south part of that, you're going to be right around 27, 28 megahertz. If you're in the Eastern Caribbean, 25 megs. People that are in South America, for the most part, throughout the whole center of the country, you're over 30 megahertz. As you head south, you're at 26. Once you get into Africa, 28 to 18 megs. So again, the sunlight over the middle of the earth really makes a big, big difference. Europe all the way through Asia and into Japan. You're on 40 meters right now. You don't reach higher until you get into the Gold Coast of Australia, around Sydney, 17 megahertz. And as you head south towards Melbourne, you're all the way on 12 megahertz. Your Hamrin shortwave forecast for today, including CB, powered by ICOM. ICOM for the love of ham radio. Daytime ham radio bands open today. Voice 20, 17, 15, and 12 in the Northern Hemisphere. Equatorial latitudes, you'll get it all. 20, 17, 15, 12, and 10. South Hemisphere, 2017, 15, 12, and 10. CB radio skip, possible medium distance skip openings in part of the Northern Hemisphere. It's not going to go very far. You're not going to make transcontinental CB skip most likely today. It just isn't there. Open, though, should make some long calls if you're in the mid and southern latitudes, though, on 11 meters. Your data should work fine 30 to 10 all latitudes. Your nighttime ambient openings 160, 80, 75, 60, 40, 30. Best DX on 40, but don't forget 20 and 17 at gray line. Shortwave bands during the day 31, 25, 22, and 19. Your shortwave nighttime bands 120, 90, 75, 60, 49, 41, 31, 25, 22, and 100% chance of 19 meters being open until about 2 hours after sunset in the mid and southern latitudes. Good to see you guys. Welcome back. All right. So, what are we talking about today? The question today, of course, is what's a goal that you have that you'd like to accomplish in radio? And this is a broad topic. Okay. It could be ham, shortwave, CB. It could be AM DXing. You got a goal in radio. What would it be to accomplish? Okay. So let me know what you think your goal would be and we'll get you taken care of on the show. All right. Tom, yep. Been complaining about how 40 meters is obliterated frequently by commercial radio and over the horizon radar. It could just be nasty. It really can be. Yeah. If you remember the Russian woodpecker, you know, over the horizon radar. It's pretty much. Yeah. And Anders, yes, our new ham, Lima Bravo 3, Bravo Juliet. We will. One of these days, we'll talk on the air. I've got to get that directional antenna up. Once that comes up, I think that'll help us a lot. Oh, my goodness. Continent number 4. That is Glenn Stevenson. Welcome, mate. Good to see you. Thanks for coming, buddy. Wow. It's nice to see you. I hope the parents are well. I hope you're doing good, too. My goodness. Wow. Actually, no, that's continent number 5, because we're North and South America. Asia, North, and we also have Europe and Australia. 5. Thank you. That honors me. Seriously, that honors me. Thank you, guys. I mean that very, very much. All right. So, Mike, Kilo Delta 2, Sierra X-ray Delta out of Jacksonville. My goal is to get all the DXCC awards I can get. That's a good one. Swordfish Radio, why over the horizon radar? Wouldn't spy satellites do the job better if they were geostationary? That's why they call it military intelligence.
No!
Yeah. There you go. Get it. Yeah. Tom, Bahrain, Alpha 92 Golf Whiskey, would like to participate in a de-expedition. Tom, you do that every day, dude, from Bahrain. You're like, what are you like? You know, you're in the top 250, top 225, somewhere in there, DXCC. Man, but I get it, right? Going on vacation, taking your gear. It is fun, but I got to tell you, it's interesting getting it through an airport. That is quite interesting to do. Glenn Stevenson out of Australia would like to be able to read CW. That might be the comment of the show. That might be. Not because I'm the same way, but because I like the humility of it. Yeah, Glenn, that's a really nice comment. Surface Radio, I'd like to take my gear to the Maldives on holiday, but the wife won't let me. That would be my radio goal. That's brilliant. I love that. That's a nice comment. That's a very nice comment. All right. We're going to have so much fun today. I'm really excited. Yesterday we talked, man, we brought up about beverage antennas. We're going to talk about the cousin to the beverage. We're going to talk about loops. Now, we're going to talk about it in a different way. We're not going to talk about, you know, metal loops you buy and you put them on tripods and you spin them around or you put them close to the ground on a tripod. No, we're going to talk about loops you actually put on the ground today. And I hope you enjoy this segment. It should be a lot of fun. Before we do that, we're going to get to our trivia questions. By the way, last month, at the very end, meaning yesterday, North America pulled it out again. I tried. I just for my friends all over the world, I really wanted to give it to you because you owned it the whole month. And then at the last day, North America got both questions right. And so they won by 10. It was 165 to 155. New month, new game, new score. Here we go. First question. Minnesota borders which Canadian prefixes? Okay. The state of Minnesota borders which Canadian prefixes? Is it A, Victor Yankee 1, B, Victor Oscar 2, C, Victor Echo 3, and Victor Echo 4? Or is it D, Victor Echo 5 and Victor Echo 6? Hit me up with A, B, C, or D. First person in with the right answer gets it right for either North America or for the world, and we'll let you know who gets it right. Okay. Cliff Bolts from the state of Virginia. Nice comment. My immediate goal is to get my hex beam up and get my DX count over 200. Whoa, that's great, Cliff. Very nice. Absolutely. That hex beam is going to make a brilliant difference for you. It's great. Swordfish Radio, first one in answers C, VE3 and VE4. And that is correct. Well done, my friend. Very, very well done. Yep, it is Victor Echo 3, Victor Echo 4. Yep. I need to find out where this is going because I'm not quite 100% sure. If I remember right, and I could be wrong because I've got a mind that works for only a few minutes, this is Great Britain, so it'd be the world, and that's 10 points. So that should be, yeah, 10 points. So it is. It is Victor Echo 3 and Victor Echo 4. Let's take a look at a big map here, and you can kind of see the W0, which really doesn't mean W0. It really means K, W, A, or N, but the point is it's zero district. Close in, Minnesota's right there, and it borders Ontario, Manitoba. Ontario is the province that has Victor Echo 3. Manitoba is Victor Echo 4. So that's the reason why the answer is C, Victor Echo 3, Victor Echo 4. Congratulations to Swordfish Radio for getting it correct on the first time. Well done. Well done. All right. Brand new game, brand new month, world with 10, North America with 0. Okay. Next question for you. This will be a fun one. What well-known country singer once held the call sign Kilo Delta for Whiskey Union Juliet? Okay. Was it A, George Strait, B, George Jones, C, Alan Jackson, or D, Patti Loveless? Hit me up with A, B, C, or D and a fun bunch of trivia coming up right after this one. Okay. Which well-known country singer once held that call sign Kilo Delta for Whiskey Union Juliet? All right. A, B, C, or D. First one in gives you your points. That gets it right. Okay. So there you go. All right. We're going to show you some cool stuff after this too. Give you an idea of some very famous hams that are from all over the world who have been ham radio operators and licensees. Pretty cool. It's pretty neat. Hope you like it. That'll be fun. That was one of the parts of the show I was so excited to do because it's like this entertainment stuff's always fun to do. It really is. All right. First one in that comes in with the right answer is actually Jeff from the state of Florida. Sorry, the state of Eastern Tennessee. He's in East Tennessee. November 4, Pop Oscar Delta. He says D, Patti Loveless, and he's 100% right. Look at that. All right, so North America with 10. Sorry, world with 10, North America with 5. Excuse me, it is Patti Loveless. Patti Loveless, ham radio operator, and her call sign was Kilo Delta 4. Whiskey Union Juliet. Let's take a look at some famous hams. Four famous radio hams who are authors. Gene Shepard, okay? If you remember the movie A Christmas Story, it was based on a book called In God We Trust, All Others Pay Cash. I must tell you, A Christmas Story is a very loose translation of that book. I've read the book, and it's very loose. The Christmas Story itself, that's my favorite movie of all time. It is. I've got to be honest, it's my number one movie. But the book just didn't really cover it. It didn't. But his call sign, Kilo 2, Oscar Romeo Sierra. Dr. Alex Comfort, okay? Kilo Alpha 6, Union X-Ray Romeo. Jeff Duntman, who's author and publisher of Corollis Group. Kilo Golf 7, Juliet Foxtrot. And David Rubin, MD. Everything you wanted to know. He is the call sign, Tango India 2, Doctor, right? Delta Romeo. That's not bad. Eight famous radio ham musicians and singers. Look at all those guys. Look at that. We got guys and gals there. You've got Patti Loveless, Kilo Delta 4, Whiskey Union Juliet, country singer. Linal Harris, also a country singer. Whiskey Delta 4, Lima Zulu Charlie. And the reason we played Bad Bad Leroy Brown at the very beginning of the show was because Jim Croce, Whiskey November 3, Oscar Quebec Whiskey. Yep. He was a ham as well. How about that? Bad, bad Leroy Brown started the show. And that was why we started the show with Jim Croce. Now, can you believe it? This is interesting about that song, okay? Bad, bad Leroy Brown. If you can still, you know, if you still love it, that means it's really good, right? Can you believe it? In 2 years, that song is going to be 50 years old. No kidding. No kidding. Also, of course, we know Chet Atkins is a ham, right? It was, you know, a ham. Also, Ronnie Millsap, Joe Walsh from the Eagles, Linnell Harris, Burl Ives, some famous hams there. Six famous radio ham politicians, David Funderburk. There you've got Barry Goldwater, who was U.S. Senator, also ran for president. Armin Meyer, U.S. Ambassador to Japan, was also involved with that. Five famous radio ham presidents and prime ministers, okay? Carlos Saul Menem, Lima Union One, Sierra Mike, President of Argentina. That's pretty cool. Also, Francesco Cossiga, who was the President of Italy, Italy Zero, Foxtrot Charlie Golf. That'd be a good one to get. Sir Thomas Davis, Premier Cook Islands, Zulu Kilo One, Alpha November, and General Anastasio Somoza, President of Nicaragua, Yankee November One, Alpha Sierra. Still got more. Eight famous radio hams from royalty and heads of state. The Prince of Kuwait, Yosef al-Sabah, 9 Kilo 2, Charlie Sierra. And I do know people have worked the King of Jordan, Julia Yankee 1. Also, the Queen of Jordan was Julia Yankee 2. So there you go. Also, we've got the Prince of Thailand, the King of Thailand, the King of Spain, Sultan of Oman. Lots of royalty involved with ham radio. 10 famous radio ham stage TV and radio people, right? Lord Brian Ricks from Great Britain, Jim Bacon, weatherman on BBC, Golf 3, Yankee Lima Alpha, Arthur Godfrey, famous in the 50s and 60s for his shows, Kilo 4 Lima India Bravo, Roy Neal, famous NBC news reporter, Walter Cronkite. He was like the voice of news, the face of news, on CBS and in North America for much of the 60s, early 70s. Kilo Bravo 2, Golf Sierra Delta. Hugh Downs, also TV game show host, is a ham. Lloyd Buckner, Stu Gilliam, Marlon Brando. Look at that. Marlon Brando, two call signs because, you know, from France also. I'm going to help him out. Kilo Alpha 6, Papa Zulu Hotel, and Fox Oscar 5, Golf Juliet was Martin Brando's. So, pretty cool. There's some famous hams for your little memory bank. Hope you enjoyed that segment. It was fun to do that. Dawn in Great Britain. I'd like to work VK on a quarter watt. I've done it as low as 1 watt from UK, but that was the last peak on 40 meters. His call sign, Golf 7, India Mike Oscar, quarter watt. Be amazing. That'd be cool, wouldn't it? Jeff, I remember when she got her license. Yeah, that was pretty important stuff. It's neat when people do that. And yeah, by the way, part of that movie, Christmas Story, part of it was filmed in Canada, in the Toronto area at school. You see the school scenes, right? The outdoor scenes? Canada. That was Canada. The ones that were done where the house was and the neighborhood and all that and Higbee's, that was Cleveland, Ohio. So that was Christmas Story. Yep, back in the day. Wow. That was fun. I still love that movie. That's my favorite. Tim Allen, no, it again, this isn't everybody, but you know what I'm saying. This is some people that maybe you don't know, right? There you go. All right, question again. What goal would you like to accomplish in radio, whether it be ham, CB, shortwave, or AMDX? We're going to talk now about somebody who we do know a little bit about. This is Heinrich Hertz. Now, why is Heinrich Hertz on your screen, and why am I talking about him? Because Heinrich Hertz was actually, according to history, the first person to use a loop antenna. It's true. Heinrich Hertz developed a wireless communication system in which he forced an electrical spark to occur in the gap of a dipole antenna. He used a loop antenna as a receiver and observed a similar disturbance back in 1886. Ever since his centimeter wave communication of 1895, Marconi had believed in the superiority of directive communications, and much of his life was devoted to pursuing this objective. In 1906, he obtained a measure of directivity with long waves using his bent antenna over ground. The ground wave antenna pattern shown may be the first measured polar diagram that was ever published. The bent antenna was later evolved into the Alexanderson multiple tuned antenna and the Beverage antenna, the V antenna, and the Bruce and rhombic antennas. This is kind of the beginning of where loop antennas came from. Heinrich Hertz, first one to do it. There is a really great bunch of videos, not just one, but a bunch It's done by Scott Wolm out of Fridley, Minnesota. His call sign is Whiskey X-Ray Zero Victor. I'd ask you to take a look at his content here on YouTube. I think he does a great job. He really does. We're going to talk about loops today, but loops on the ground. It's true, and you can do it. Take a look at this loop. This first one's going to show you loops on the ground, but it's going to show you a loop on the ground, but it's also going to show you what it does on signal to noise. Remember, we talked about this yesterday. Loops and beverages work signal to noise. You're not going to get gain from them. Okay, you're not going to get a stronger signal. Please don't get them confused. There's a big difference between a strong signal with tons of noise in it and a quieter signal with little or no noise in it. That's what you're looking for, signal to noise. Maybe the signal's in an S6 or an S2 even, but there's no noise with it. But the other one at S9 has an S7 or S8 noise floor. Loops and beverage antennas will work signal noise. That means your signal, your S number is just going to come down, but your noise floors also crash. So it's much easier to hear the signal. Let's take a look. The first one, this is a ground loop and it works. Take a look.
What of my low noise receive antennas? Nope, it's not the tree trunk you see in the upper left. This is a KK5YJ loop on the ground, or log. This design was introduced to me by Steve, K0SR, after he found it on the KK5YJ homepage. Essentially, it's just wire on the ground. Let's go into it a little bit more in detail. Before continuing, I want to offer my apologies to Matt, KK5JY, for getting his call sign incorrect during the production of this video. In a moment of dyslexia, I got the J and the Y mixed up and was calling him KK5YJ, when in reality, as you can see, it's KK5JY. The original video has been deleted from YouTube, and I'm offering up now this corrected version. The narration is still wrong, but I have added graphics to indicate the proper and correct call sign. Here is Matt Roberts, KK5YJ's webpage on the log antenna. Now, going into all these details is beyond the scope of this video, so I will link to this page below. This video is going to cover my installation of this antenna at my station. My log is approximately 130 feet in total length. It's laid out in roughly a square, kind of a rectangle. Now, I'm not sure why I picked 130 feet. There's some different conjecture on how large you want it to be or how long you want your log to be. You're just going to have to experiment with that. I just kind of picked 130 feet because that's how large my front yard is. And I put it in the front yard because that's away from my transmitting antennas, which is just good amateur radio practice. Here is a rough schematic view of my loop on ground antenna. This is a difficult shot to take because you need a lens wide enough to show everything, so I was forced to use a 12mm fisheye lens on my full-frame DSLR. Thus, we have some of the curvature that you see in the frame. Regardless, here it is, and you can see it's basically a rough square, maybe a rectangle. What is that, a square tangle? I don't know. Here is the transformer box in the lower center. Now, the length of this is approximately 130 feet. You can experiment with different lengths, and a lot of that's going to be determined by the size of footprint you have in your yard. My log is comprised of DX Engineering Premium antenna wire, but you can use any type of antenna wire you want. This seems to be pretty durable, so that's why I use that. And I hold it in place in the ground with the DX Engineering ground staples. Now, this one's a little rusted because this is an older one. Once you have your wire in place, just push the DX Engineering staple down as far as you can get it. And we'll push it down just like that. And what that's going to do is not only hold it in place, but also is going to keep the wire below the deck of your mower, because obviously if you hit it with your mower, your log is ruined. As a precaution, for the first few weeks after you installed your log, I suggest raising the deck on your mower. After a few weeks, eventually the grass grows over the wire and there's just no issues with it whatsoever. You can mow over it, you can walk over it. If you got kids, they can play over it because they won't even know it's there. My log utilizes a transformer designed by Steve Root, K0SR, and I'll detail that and this conduit box here in a little bit. For now, one end of the log goes here, the other end goes here. This is being fed by RG59 coax. Doesn't have to be anything special because this is a receive antenna, not a transmit antenna. And Steve NE0U suggested a Wireman choke ballon to help reduce noise. And you can loosely see that in your picture.
As we take a look at my roof-mounted Mosley Yagi, this is a good time to tell you that the log is a low-band receive antenna only. It is not for transmitting. If you transmit into the log, your radio will not be happy with you.
Here's a closer look at the transformer box as promised. Now, I got mine at the local big box store, and I found that to be much cheaper than they were online, so that's something to consider if you're thrifty like I am. Here's a look at the finished product. Now, I am not Paul, Oscar Mike Zero Echo Tango. He's very handy at this stuff, and you should check out his channel, because he's got some interesting projects on there. But nevertheless, I was able to fashion this up pretty quickly. It just required a hole for the SO239, and a couple of drill holes on the side for the connecting hardware, which I just got at the local big box store. Probably should put a lock washer on there to hold the wire in place better, so that would be a good idea. Even if you're unskilled at this stuff as I am, it doesn't take long to get one of these things put together. One other quick note, I did do a little drain hole here at the bottom of the conduit box to allow water and moisture to escape. Now that I popped the top, let's take a look inside. I'm going to start first with this 12-3 transformer designed by Steve, K0SR. And I'll detail this here in a little bit, but a quick disclaimer, none of this stuff is my design. The original log design was done by KK5YJ, and this transformer design was done by Steve K0SR. All I'm doing is showing you how I put mine together. Now, this is the 12 winding side of the transformer, and the two leads from that go to the connecting hardware on either side. And the 3 winding side on this side of the transformer would go to the SO239, and you can put it either in the hot or the ground, it does not matter. And you'll notice here that the drain hole for moisture release is right here in the corner. Now, to keep this transformer from rattling around, I used a Max earplug. It's remarkable how long these things last, and it keeps it from rattling around during transport. Here are the components that I used to make my transformer. I got these binocular cores off of eBay, and I just went with this 28 gauge red magnet wire. I don't think the gauge really matters that much, but I went with 28 gauge and it seems to work pretty well for me. Let's take a look at the transformer building process. Now I start first by marking my binocular core with some whiteout, and that indicates the larger turn side, in this case 12 on this side. And I use about 2 feet of wire for the 12 turn side and about a foot on the 3 turn side. Make sure you leave yourself enough wire here so it can connect to your conduit box. And you put it through the binocular core and then you come back around. And you see now there's one loop there, but that's not done. That's not a complete turn. We have to come back through here. It's a little tricky because I'm half watching the camcorder viewing screen and half watching this. Keep these taut here. See that kind of got loose? You don't want to pull them super tight, just keep them taut. Okay? And then back around again, back through the other side again. Now after you've done that, you'll notice on this side there are 2 loops, and on this side there is 1. That is 1 full loop, or 1 full turn on this transformer. Now you have to do 11 more on this side, and then you start the process over on the other side and have 3. Again, make sure you leave yourself plenty of lead wire here to connect to your conduit box. And then when you're done, make sure you scrape off the ends. You have to scrape off this insulation because otherwise you won't get a connection. After just a short time, your transformer will look something like this. Here is the 12 winding side, which goes to the loop itself. And there's the dot indicating that. And here's the 3 winding side, which goes to the SO239. I mentioned this is a low band receive antenna only, correct? If you happen to transmit with it, not only do you anger your radio, your signal will go nowhere and you will probably destroy the transformer inside of it. Now, in my own admittedly hasty reaction to wanting to work DX, I will sometimes engage in the ready, fire, aim process. If that happens to you, it's a good idea to do what I do, and that is to have a backup box ready to go. Now that we've got the log installed, let's see how it works. It's going to be a few hours before darkness arrives and the low bands become active, so I've got some yard work to do in the meantime. Evening has arrived. Let's see what's on the low bands.
a look at the log in action. That is Delta 68 Charlie from the Comoros Islands here on 80 meters CW. I just did a video for them, and I'll be posting that on my channel in a little bit. Time is 23:35 Zulu, which is 6:35 p.m. Central Daylight Time. And that is using that antenna that is laying on the ground. Unfortunately, I was not able to do a true A-B comparison between the transmit antenna and the log receive antenna on D68CCC. The reason being, of course, he's not transmitting continuously because he's trying to work a pileup. However, it did give you an idea of the log's performance. To that end, there are at least 24 videos on my YouTube channel right now of examples of the log antenna in action on both 160 and 80 meters. Each time I describe it as a low noise receive antenna, so there's plenty of examples to work with. However, let's take a look at a true A-B comparison between the transmit antenna and the log receive antenna on a stateside CW signal on 80 meters. Let's go back to the transmitting antenna. Back to the log, adding a couple of preamps. Now you're gonna lose sensitivity on the log for sure, but I think the signal to noise ratio is better. He sounds cleaner on the log. Back to the transmitting antenna, removing the preamps. That's my 80 meter WAR. There's QSB on his signal, to be fair. I think the log is a clear win.
There you go. And we got one more, because I know we got some sideband folks who will want to know about this. And if you saw yesterday's video regarding the beverage antenna, that was done, and I think very well, by Jeff, November Juliet 2, Union Sierra. I mean, there's no comparison between using your dipole or your vertical antenna. Even a Yagi, I'm serious, because it doesn't work signal to noise. It works gain. And that's good. There's nothing wrong with that. Gain is always good to have. But low signal to noise is really good when you've got a good signal to noise ratio. It makes a huge difference. Now, one of the other things that I think that Scott did a great job on, and this is the sideband portion of it. His call sign again, Whiskey X-Ray Zero Victor. Scott is out of the state of Minnesota, a town called Fridley. And he does a great job with this antenna showing what it can do on sideband. And this is a good A to B comparison. So folks that maybe have verticals or dipoles, comparing it to a loop on the ground, what it can do on the low bands, take a look at what Scott accomplished. This is a fantastic A to B comparison of a ground loop, literally wire on the ground, compared to a vertical way up in the air.
In this video, I'm going to show you the value of having more than one antenna for receive. I'm currently listening to Scott Wright, K0 Mike Delta from Rochester, Minnesota, here on 160 meters during the CQ sideband contest. Now, this is the NE0U EZL, the transmit antenna. You can see we've got S9 in noise. And you can hear him in there, but the signal noise ratio is not real good. Okay, now I'm going to switch to the KK5JY loop on ground antenna.
See the noise floor drop?
It's night and day.
Thank you. Kilo Zero, Mike Delta contest.
It's not even close.
Kilo Zero, Mike Denmark contest. Kilo Whiskey 9 Romeo 59 Minnesota.
There's a transmit antenna and the KK5JY loop on ground.
CQ contest, Kilowatt Zero, Mike Delta contest. CQ contest, Kilowatt Zero, Mike Delta contest.
Not even close. Now that doesn't mean that the KK5JY loop on ground or any receive antenna will always work better than the transmit antenna, but a lot of times a receive antenna is going to be a better way of hearing the station you're after than your transmitting antenna. The best advice I can give you is to try different things. If you don't have a dedicated receive antenna, try a non-resonant antenna. For example, maybe use a 40 or 30 meter antenna to listen on 160, and then use, of course, your transmit antenna for the band that you're on. There is no such thing as a magical antenna, but it's good to have different options, and tonight is proving that. Listening to Scott here. Now, I could have worked in here on the transmit antenna, but listen how much better it sounds on the receive antenna.
CQ contest, Kilo Zero, Mike Delta contest. Whiskey Zero, Oscar Romeo. Hi, Bill, 5-9 Minnesota.
Well, 5-9 Minnesota, Scott, and good luck.
Thanks, Bill. Same to you. Nice to hear you on. 73.
Again, the transmit antenna?
Contest, Kilowatt Zero, Mike Delta contest.
And the KK5JY loop on ground. By the way, there is a link. In fact, I'll post it and maybe show it even right now. A link to the build that I did of the KK5JY loop on ground antenna. Ian XFS, that's Golf Zero Charlie November November in England, also has a fine video on this wonderful receive antenna. It's not a perfect antenna. It's not always going to work better all the time, but it's a nice tool to have in your receive arsenal. Thanks for watching in 73 from Whiskey X-Ray Zero Victoria.
That's great stuff. Very great stuff. And I really, really want to take a moment to thank Scott for doing a great job on a great video. I think that was really good. That really was. Talking about, you know, a loop antenna. And I know, Scott, you mentioned about QRM. No. Agree to disagree. Totally. A loop or a receive, if you're using beverages or you're using a loop, you know, on the ground, there's no comparison to a QRM eliminator. There just isn't, buddy. I love you. You know I do. The thing about what he built is it's kind of, think about like a transmit antenna that's a dipole. It's going to, you know, broadside. It's the same thing. You're going to get, you know, you're going to get your lobes going two directions unless you're doing a beverage with, you know, diodes on the end that's going to, you know, make it go like an arrow. That's called a long wave antenna. The wave goes down the wire and straight ahead towards the direction it's pointed. On a ground loop, the ground loop is typically going to be bidirectional. That's how it works. But the difference is you're not going to have the noise floor issue that you have with your vertical or your dipole with a, you know, something that's added to it to try and eliminate some of the noise. It just doesn't work the same way. It really impacts the RX. It does such a tremendous job on a receive antenna for a radio. And that's, I think, one of the things that hams really struggle with a lot is that they focus so much on takeoff angle and they focus so much on, you know, their radiation polar patterns, all of that. They love to know what their transmit antenna is doing, which is really important, but it doesn't matter if you can't hear as well. Now, if you've got a directional, you got a Yagi up on, you know, a 70 or 80 foot tower, brilliant. That's great. You can also hear and transmit good, but you're going to hear much better by using a dedicated receive antenna. Keep in mind, you want to keep it away from your transmit antenna. You don't want it anywhere near that because it will make a gigantic difference. It will. I mean, both yesterday's video and today's video regarding yesterday with the beverage antenna going four directions, today with a just wire on the ground, literally wire on the ground, and what it can do. And the thing to keep in mind, if you turn it, if you're able to physically turn it to go, you know, 45 degrees, it's going to be broadside the other way. So it's going to, say, for example, originally it was going to go, you know, east-west there in Minnesota. Turn it, you know, another, you know, 90 degrees. Now it's going to go north-south. That's the way it's going to hear. It just is a phenomenally easy thing to do. And most of our ham radios that have RX inputs on them just stay empty. The SO239 never goes on it. And that's really a shame because most high-end shortwave people really know the value of a good antenna. And it really does make a difference, especially if you're on a vertical or a dipole. If you've got a directional, you pretty much have the best of both worlds. However, the signal noise ratio is still there on the directional antenna. It just is. So yeah, that's it. I do want to make a quick welcome because we did see him pop in while we were here doing the middle of that. Sean is here from the UK, 2 Echo 0 X-ray Bravo Tango. Welcome, Sean. Good to see you and a very good evening to you in the UK. Thanks, buddy. Yep. It's good to see you. Thank you for coming. Thank you very much for coming. And yeah, I thought it was a good demo. Both were good. I thought both were really good demos. It showed really what they do. And it's so important to understand you can see it on the waterfall. Replay it, see it on the waterfall. You'll see the waterfall color just completely changed. Goes to black, literally, because the noise floor goes down. The signal-to-noise ratio is what you're working on those antennas. You're not working a gain antenna. It's a big difference. Yeah, really is. Andy New from the UK just goes to show the S meter readings aren't always indicative of readability. Exactly. Yep. Take away. It's kind of like, you know, having a fuzzy TV picture from the old days and then going HD. It's a big difference. You know, the screen may not be brighter, but you're seeing better. Yeah. Adam from Ocala says to Tom, our club gained access to our local Mars station. It has two giant rhombics. Whoa. Over 10,000 feet of wire, I bet. Absolutely. And that's what WRMI does. I mean, they've got over a mile of antennas there. That's why they can transmit all over the world. You know, you've got rhombics going in different directions, and all of a sudden you're picking up continents. Pretty cool. So, and by the way, that's going to be fun to do tomorrow. If you have a chance and you would like to listen on shortwave, it's a short show. It's a very, very short show. I will tell you, it's different, but the same, if that makes sense. As much as you can put into 14 minutes and 30 seconds, okay? So a little bit of ham news and radio news too, not just ham, but radio news. A little bit of HF forecast, and I try and put a lot more into the mailbag segment. That's important because I want to engage with people who listen to the show that's on WRMI. So if you would like to know about the schedule, the first airing will be tomorrow to the Hawaiian South Pacific area plus Australia, New Zealand. It'll be at 0815 UTC at 7730 kilohertz. Europe, North Africa, and Middle East also tomorrow at 2015 UTC. That's going to be on 15770 kilohertz. North America gets the show on Thursday, 7:30 p.m. Eastern on 93.95 kilohertz. Caribbean, South America, and Central America will have it Thursday, 8:15 Eastern time on 99.55. And you'll also be able to hear it on stream there at www.wrmi.net. It's called CQ Calling. It is a short version of Ham Radio Live, and it's something that hopefully will help not only promote our hobby, which is something I really hope it does. I want it to promote our ham radio hobby, but also to promote radio, that it's okay to love any kind of radio. There's no difference. We all have the same love of radio. It's just a different niche of it. So that's the way it works. I want to thank you all for coming. I don't want you to feel bad, Mike. Don't you dare. You know I love you to pieces. And doggone it, we use your map all the time. We call you the map guy because you are the map guy. And you're a brilliant young man. We thank the world of you. That's Mike Kilo Delta 2 Sierra X-ray Delta. One of the best people here on this channel and someone I admire very, very much. So, a question coming in here real quick from, there's my screen. Hi, screen. A question coming in from Jeff. So that can be a regular thing here. Yeah, every week. Be on every week. Same frequency, same time. WRMI called CQ Calling. Listen for it. And I did listen to it last night from actually the Hawaiians. No, excuse me. It was the one beaming to South America and Caribbean. I was hearing it off the backside of the antenna. I heard their South America and Caribbean beam coming here all the way to the Northwest. They've got a heck of a signal. They really do. So it'll be every week at those times. So, all right, guys, we're going to wrap it up. I thank you for coming today to Ham Radio Live. I thank you for your questions, your comments, and I invite you to try a receive antenna. Whether you use, if you've got property, do a beverage. That's the best antenna you can do. Low noise, but you need a lot of wire, a ton of wire and a lot of land. If you can do maybe a loop antenna, a big one on the ground like that, keep it away from your transmitting antenna. You'll be fine. If you can use a small loop, maybe you're going to use like the Wilbrook, the ALN 1530LN. Great antenna. Wonderful receive loop, really is. Just keep it at least 15 meters from your transmit antenna. MFJ makes some great loops. You can make your own loops, but they work. They really do. Study, learn, and use. Make mistakes, but don't make mistakes with your expensive gear. All right, folks, we'll see you next time on Ham Radio Live. I thank you for coming again. Thank you again to the folks at WRMI, and most of all, thanks to each of you. Without you guys, this would never have happened for me, and I never thought it would happen again. Thank you. Wherever you may be in this world, God bless you. Thank you for watching Ham Radio Live. Until next time, goodbye, everybody.
Well, now to see how we go to score with the weather. Tonight, rain will die out, except in northern Scotland, with temperatures falling to 5 Celsius. That's 41 Fahrenheit in the Scottish Glens. Tomorrow, there may be a little sunshine in the south and east, but most places will have a good deal of cloud, with some showery outbreaks of rain. Tomorrow's temperatures, another cool day, especially in the wetter parts of the north. And that is the weather.
When she got back, there was a smell of smoke.
Where's Mummy gone? To the fish and chip shop, of course.
When she opened the door, there were flames.
Here, Mum said you wasn't to touch that. It's all right.
Whatever you've taught them, you can't be sure they'll play safe.
I want to do it. Give it here.
Don't leave children alone in the house, even for a short time.
Mum! 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 Mum!
That was a public information film. Well, with the time rapidly approaching 12 minutes past midnight, that's where we come to the end of Wednesday evening's programmes here on BBC One. If you'd like a little more company, on Radio 1 right now you'll find Whispering Bob Harris. And if you turn to Radio 2, Peter Clayton presents Jazz Parade. But from all of us here at BBC One Television in London, on behalf of all of my colleagues, this is Andy Taylor wishing you a very good night. Good night.
Remember, when things look bad,